everybody, I am Gareth here from What Culture Wrestling, here to bring you all the lovely NXT ups and downs that you know and love every single week. Only I don't do it every single week because normally it's Adam Cleary here and, well, for whatever reason, he's had his day off today. So that's absolutely fine because instead, you got me on my lovely Game of Thrones bed in front of a clown and a bunch of other clowns. But we're not here to talk about the change in personnel. We are here to talk about NXT. And of course, it was a pretty big week. We had the number one contenders week, as I'm going to pretty much call it for the rest of this episode. We saw the number one contenders battle royale for the NXT Women's Championship. Number one contenders. I don't think I've said that enough already. We also had the gauntlet match, the five-way gauntlet to decide the new number one contender for the NXT title at TakeOver. And then there was other tag team championship number one contender stuff. And then for some reason, a number one contendership just got announced on Twitter. Yeah. There's a lot to get into, so let's just jump straight on into it. And I don't think I have any entrance music. So. Okay, to kick off this episode of NXT Takeoff to Takeover, which is what it was being called, we had Candice LeRae popping down to the ring. The ring was already full of loads of, like, these incredibly talented women that the NXT roster has at this point, because we were going to have this number one contenders battle royale for the number one contendership for Io Shirai's NXT Women's Championship at Takeover. I got there. Yeah, so for whatever reason, Candice LeRae got an entrance, but the likes of Dakota Kai, the likes of Shotzi Blackheart, they did not. But it was soon revealed why this was the case, because Tegan Nox had been absolutely battered backstage by Candice LeRae, and this entrance was pretty much a way of, I don't know, filling the time so they could have this little clip showing Candice LeRae just brutalizing Tegan Nox's knee, really absolutely destroying it in between a box, just slamming it. And Tegan Nox sold it like an absolute champion. I was wincing here, sat watching it at home. I was wincing. I was like, no, Tegan Nox, I don't want you to die. Don't do it. But this did mean that Tegan Nox was not going to be involved in this match. So Candice LeRae was instantly the biggest heel in my eyes in this match. And then Rhea Ripley got an entrance because she's, well, the biggest star in the match. But I'd say the biggest thing in this match, the biggest, let's say, storyline going all the way through it, was Rhea Ripley and Raquel Gonzalez just having a battle, really, of who can eliminate the most people. And yeah, they pretty much did. I'm not going to go through, obviously, every single elimination because we would be here for quite some time, but the final four in the end were Katie Catanzaro, Shotzi Blackheart, Dakota Kai, and Candice LeRae. I really like Katie Catanzaro in this match because she did loads of Ninja Warrior stuff. Like, she was, like, doing handstands. She was, like, hanging on to the side of the plexiglass at times. It was really cool. I think that is her wheelhouse at this point. But she was eventually knocked out by Dakota Kai, and then Dakota Kai was knocked out by Shotzi Blackheart. And then there was a weird little segment, but I really liked it, well, section, where Candice LeRae was hanging on these steel steps, and it was like she was going to get knocked off, Shotzi Blackheart was going to go for the kill, and then Shotzi went for the kill, and then Candice LeRae did like a monkey flip thing and flipped her out of the ring. So there you have it, Candice LeRae is the new number one contender for Io Shirai's NXT Women's Championship. She will now face her at TakeOver, and that's a match I'm looking forward to. It's quite fresh, it's something a bit different. You've also got that nice little storyline between Tegan Nox and Candice LeRae, like if Candice LeRae is out now for a little while with a bad knee, because she has had those bad knee injuries in the past, she could come back, maybe even cost Candice LeRae her match against Io Shirai. Those two could battle. We'll see what happens. But most importantly, this all gets an up. But then, weirdly, just after you'd seen Johnny Gargano's wife go through all this big battle royale and earn her way through just outsmarting Shotzi Blackheart, earning her way into that championship match at TakeOver, Johnny Gargano came to the ring, started celebrating with his wife, because, you know, he's allowed to do that. But that instantly reminded all of us, because the commentary team soon did that as well, that Johnny Gargano had just been put into another match with Damian Priest for his North American Championship at TakeOver, just because he's Johnny Gargano. He didn't really have to earn it, he didn't have to do anything. It was just announced. I think William Regal put it on Twitter before the show had even started, and it instantly just made everything weird. But because it was just thrown together and we weren't really given a reason why it happened, for me it's got to be a damn. Sorry. Yeah, then after this celebration little moment between Johnny and Candice when they were in the ring, they were just having a bit of a, yay, we just won something, look at us. Damian Priest was backstage and he had a segment where he was just talking about how good Austin Theory is, and he's a lot more talented than his recent record suggests. Which is true, but it just didn't bode very well because we knew they were going to have a match later on, and I instantly thought, uh-oh, Austin Theory is going to lose. And then straight after this, we had probably my most favourite segment of the entire show, and there was a couple, actually, no, there was a couple of segments I really liked, but this one was right up there. You had Fandango dressed as Sherlock Holmes, pretty much. He was talking to little fragments of the tag team division in NXT, like every single team had one member there. William Regal came in and was like, what's going on right now? And he said, well, Mr. Regal's like, no, stop, don't do the bad British accent, just speak to me. And he was like, right, I've got this idea. So we'll get one team member from every single team and they can tag with another tag team, and then those two tag teams will fight, and then the winner of those two tag teams, they face each other, and then the winner of those two tag teams face us. And if you're a little bit lost, that's exactly what happened with William Regal, because then he looked at Danny Burch and he was like, what does he mean? Then Danny Burch gave him some really odd, I think it was Cockney rhyming slang. And William Regal got this straight away and went, yep, cool, I understand now, walked away. And yeah, this will become a bit clearer later on. Next up, we had a match that was announced last week, and it's been bubbling kind of just under the surface for the last couple of weeks. And you've had Tommaso Ciampa and Jake Atlas have really been at odds with each other since Tommaso Ciampa came back. It's been a bit of a weird comeback so far for Ciampa, because obviously he came back, battered Jake Atlas, then got put in that Fatal 4-Way Iron Man match thing and didn't win. And then he beat up another dude, then he beat up Jake Atlas again. Now they're having a match. The match itself was pretty good because you saw Jake Atlas just giving his all and looking like an absolute ball of fire, which I think's always great, makes him look awesome. And there was also a really nice little callback moment where he attempted to do that slingshot catapult thing that Tommaso Ciampa did to him. He was trying to do that to him under the ring, but then the ref was like, no, I'll DQ you. And it was a bit like, no, ref, stop being a spoil sport. But then as it looked like Jake Atlas was about to maybe seal the biggest victory of his career so far, doing the weird cartwheel DDT thing that he does, Tommaso Ciampa caught him with a kick and then hit him with the Willow's Bell. But he did not stop there. After being down like in a pinning situation, he was like, nope, I'm not happy with that. He stood up and he was like, oh, well, O'Reilly's not going to help you out now like he did last week when I was beating you up and he stopped me beating you up. That's not going to happen. I'm going to just destroy you on my own now. And that's exactly what he did. He picked him up. He hit him with like a modified fairy tale ending, which still looked pretty cool. And then he got the victory. And yeah, then he just walked away and was like, look at what I've just done to Jake Atlas. I'm an absolute badass. I'm sadistic. I'm not sure what this means for Tommaso Ciampa going forward, because there was the little hint here. He was saying like, Kyle's not going to save you now. Does that mean he's going to maybe go after Kyle O'Reilly? Which could have some serious repercussions if when we get to the end of the show, you'll know what I mean. But I'm at least a little bit more intrigued about Tommaso Ciampa than what I was last week. So I guess I'm giving that up. Right, now we had like back-to-back promo segments, which I don't mind when that happens, because if they're good promos, they keep the show going along. It's something a little bit different. The first one we had was Ridge Holland, who's obviously, he's a Yorkshireman. He's a fellow northerner like me. I'm going to stop talking like that now because it don't work very well on me. But he had a really cool promo when he was like talking about how when he was 8 years old, he was jumped by some lads and then he battered all the lads. And then it said something about him being a rugby player, which he was a rugby league player for years. I think it worked because it just showed that he's an absolute badass. He's not the kind of guy that you'd want to be, I don't know, caught in a dark alley with, because I think he'd absolutely obliterate you. So, yeah, I like this. And then this was followed by another promo, which was hyping up the gauntlet match, which is set to go down at the end of the night. And obviously this promo, well, it had a lot to do, really, because this match was thrown together 7 days ago. Nobody really knew it was coming. The entrance had been announced all week in an attempt to promote it as well. So it was, yeah, I think it did a job. It did what it had to do. Every single person after watching this promo, I was like, yeah, okay, I could see them challenging. I quite like that. Oh, Cameron Grimes. Oh, no, I like that. Oh, Timothy Thatcher. Ooh, blah. And it just got me very excited for the match. So it did its job. I'm getting very excited. I think I've had too much coffee. Right, now, following on from that brilliant Sherlock Holmes odd promo segment talking bit that happened earlier on in the night, we had the tag team match. And I'm just going to take a minute to explain this again a little bit better. So we had Roderick Strong of the Undisputed Era and Danny Burch of Burch and Lorcan. They were one team. And then you also had Raul Mendoza of Legado del Fantasma. They could have said that right. I've not really said that on live television for a while. This isn't live, never mind. And he was teaming up with Fabian Aichner of the Imperium. Yes, there it is. There are all the teams. Yes, so they had these two halves of a team together and the other two halves of a team together. Whoever won this match, those two halves would then become wholes and they would face each other. It wasn't announced when, but they will face each other, I promise. The match itself was really cool because I like when you have this dynamic of mismatched tag teams, unlikely alliances, and you have people arguing, slapping each other. It's like, no, we should be a team. No, I'm not going to be a team. I like that. It's really cool. It gets an up, obviously, because of that. The actual match itself was hard-hitting because you had four hard-hitting dudes. And I really like the actual chemistry of the match because this is something you don't normally get when you've got just straight tag teams taking each other on because you're trying to work as a tag team. Whereas with this, everyone was an individual really working for themselves to achieve a collective goal. So everyone had their own moments to just be individually brilliant. I had Roderick Strong going on like a suplex mission at one point. Raul Mendoza was flying around the place. It was good. I really liked it. And of course, we did have Austin Theory and Damian Priest in a big match coming up next. And right, this one's going to get a really, really tentative down, okay? And I'll explain why, because I like Austin Theory. I think he's brilliant, he's a young star, he's got a lot of charisma, he's so smarmy and cocky and arrogant, which I think suits him down to a T. He can really do something with that character. But he's now lost three matches in a row since coming back to NXT in September, which, it is what it is. I mean, you can look good in defeat. I think he looked great in defeat in this match. I have to say that. Again, he had a couple moments where I was like, you're just going to be a star, kid. You're going to go far. He had those moments, but you can only lose so many times before people start thinking, wow, that's a loser right there. And I think this is, yeah, I think he's on thin ice. But Damian Priest did a pretty good job in just using all of his unorthodox strikes to discombobulate Austin Theory all the way through the match. He ended up winning in the end. And as he was celebrating, he had his little North American title up high and was doing all of his archer things, looking up like an archer. Johnny Gargano popped up again, so that's three times he's popped up in this show, I think, so far. Super kicked him in the face, and then he did the bow and arrow thing to the ground at Priest. And yeah, all this did for me personally was just remind me that the North American title scene's a bit of a mess, to be honest. I mean, you had that great match with Thatcher last week, which I really enjoyed, but again, I would have probably preferred a bit of a build, maybe have that match at TakeOver, maybe have this over the next couple of weeks. Could have had Thatcher and Priest just going at it, being, oh, I'm gonna rip your arm off in a submission, and Priest being like, no, you're not, I'm gonna kick you in the face. I would have been up for that. This just felt rushed and hasty, and it didn't do much for me. Also, I don't know how I missed this. Like, I've somehow missed this while watching the actual show itself. I've had to go back on YouTube and find the actual video of it happen. But there was a weird segment promo video of somebody in night vision goggles talking in weird cryptic voice language stuff, and yeah, just like, there was a big glass cabinet with an NXT title in it, and they were like, oh, this is my belt, and it's always been my belt, I'm going to come back from it, it's my property. And then they threw a pipe at it and took the belt away, and then the date for NXT TakeOver, I think, are we calling it 31? NXT TakeOver 31 flashed up on screen, that's the 4th of October. So, is there going to be a return or a debut? It seems like a return if they're saying it's their NXT title, but I don't know, apart from Tommaso Ciampa, I can't really think of many people on that show right now who've been a champion and could be coming back for the champion. It's very confusing. I think that's what it was meant to do, but I'm intrigued. But back to the show I was actually watching. Isaiah Swerve Scott then popped up. He had a promo. He was talking about Santos Escobar, talking about the fact that he beat him twice already. He's got two wins over this Cruiserweight champion, and that means he's got his eyes set on becoming the new champion, which, yeah, fair enough. You got a reason. After this, though, we had a Ridge Holland squash match after his promo segment that I really enjoyed. He came out with his Peaky Blinders cap on, his nice big trench coat, and he absolutely murked somebody. He destroyed an enhancement talent, absolutely obliterated him, and he had his new finisher, which was the Northern Grit, I think it was. It was like a suplexy type thing. He looked really good. He looked like a force of nature. He's a big powerhouse. He's everything I like out of my wrestling, to be honest. And he's from the north, so I'm super biased. And I hope he just, I was nearly going to say goes to the moon, but that's Cameron Grimes' thing. For now, he's just getting up. He's getting up from me. Then, after this, we had Io Shirai. She was backstage, and she was having a bit of a talky-talk with Sarah Schreiber. I think she had a busy night, Sarah Schreiber. She was just talking to everybody. She's just constantly with the microphone, just shoving it in everyone's faces. She was saying, well, Candice LeRae is going to be your new challenger for TakeOver. How do you feel about that? Io Shirai was like, oh, just never really been a big fan of Candice, is what it is. Then Candice popped up with Johnny Gargano again. I'm losing count of how many times he's on this show, but he popped up again. And they were squabbling, and Johnny Gargano was like, I can't even understand what you're saying, but the way you're saying it sounds really nasty, which actually did make me laugh a little bit. Then Damian Priest popped up, he punched Gargano, they then got separated, they were like, ugh. And I had a sneaky feeling, and I thought, well, this is probably going to lead to a tag match, and later on in the night, it got confirmed by William Regal that, yes, they're going to be in a tag match next week, which will probably be really good, I guess, but again, eh. And now we have made it to our main event of the evening, the Gauntlet 5-Way Elimination Match between Cameron Grimes, Timothy Thatcher, Bronson Reed, Kyle O'Reilly, and Kushida. Very proud of myself for getting all that in one. First of all, we've got to really just forget about the fact that this match was thrown together because the NXT Championship scene hasn't really properly recovered from the fact that Karrion Kross went down injured at TakeOver 30. So this match is just a way of papering over that and just going, ah, forget all that happened, we're just going to find a new contender. And to be honest, if this is the way they were going to do it, what a great way of doing it. The match started off with Kushida and O'Reilly. They were going at it. They were having like a grappling game of chess, which I absolutely love because I love just legitimate grappling in MMA. So I love it when it's fused over into wrestling. And yeah, they just turn each other into noodles for a while. It was great. And then after this, Bronson Reed popped into the ring. He just steamrolled into there, started battering everybody. And it was great because this is what kept happening. Every time somebody come in, every 4 minutes, the energy would just get pumped back into the match. It was like a mini Royal Rumble. Every time somebody comes in, you're like, oh my God. And it's, yeah, it just keeps everything chugging along really well. But after just knocking each other around for a little bit, it was looking like Kushida was starting to pick up a bit of momentum. He was looking really good. He was looking really consistent in the match. And then out of nowhere, Velveteen Dream snuck into the match and hit him with a Dream Valley Driver. And then Kushida was smashed into the floor by a tsunami splash thing from Bronson Reed, and he was out. That was him done. And the reason I'm so deflated by this is the fact that it's just the typical thing with Velveteen Dream right now. You don't want him on television because of what's going on outside of the ring. It just distracts you away from the brilliant work that Kushida's been doing and the brilliant work that everyone else was doing in this match. It just pulled me out of it. I didn't like that. I can't give it a down, but it's like, it's there. It's not a good thing that happened in this good match. But then after this, Timothy Thatcher joined the fray, and then after that, Cameron Grimes came in, and then there was just this brilliant moment where everyone was just flying around the ring. You had like, Kyle O'Reilly was just like a pinball, and just Bronson Reed was smashing into everybody. Thatcher's trying to pull everyone's arms off, and Cameron Grimes was just, oh, it was great. I loved it. I'll be honest, if you had to choose like an MVP of the match going all the way through it, I think Reed genuinely was. He had so many moments where he was using innovative offense. He looked like an absolute powerhouse, just a monster, so hard to take down. For me, he's my MVP. Obviously, he was the first one to get, well, the next one to get knocked out of the match. But yeah, he looked great coming out of this. He did get eliminated after trying a tsunami splash onto Timothy Thatcher. He missed it. Then Kyle O'Reilly did like a flying jumping knee to his spine, knocked him out. That was him done. And then there were three. So then Thatcher, Grimes, and O'Reilly, they were just trying their best to like one up everybody. And then there was a great moment. There was like a headlock submission and an ankle lock, like a two-way submission thing. It was just, there was so much going on. And then O'Reilly, out of nowhere, just scored a roll-up on Thatcher, which is so embarrassing for Thatcher because he's like the submission maneuver grapple expert, and he just got outmaneuvered by O'Reilly. And this was like a little running theme all the way through this match. I felt like O'Reilly just adapted to everybody he was in the ring with. He showed that he can pretty much do it all, which I think probably was the aim. And then Cameron Grimes thought he'd won the whole thing, him with a cave-in, but then as he went for the pin, O'Reilly got his foot on the ropes, he thought he won it, he was like, I've done it, I'm going to the moon! But he was not going to the moon, he was going straight into the mat, because after another failed this time attempt at the cave-in, he jammed his knee, so O'Reilly smelt the blood in the water like a shark, not the shark that ate Tozawa, that's a completely different thing, but he smelt that blood in the water, he went straight for the knee, put him in a knee bar and tapped him out. Kyle O'Reilly is going to take over for the NXT Championship. Oh my God, I'm so excited. Yeah, just great. What a good choice. That gets just all the ups. If I had a yellow jacket, I'd put it on. All I've got is some yellow underwear. You don't want to see that. After this, O'Reilly was celebrating in the ring, and then you had Roderick Strong come in, and then Adam Cole came in and like celebrated as well. There was no real obvious signs of him being a bit like, you're going after my old belt. I'm not very happy with this, but rest assured, he is not going to be completely happy with this, that this has gone on. And then Finn Balor came down, did his whole shooting bullet club prince thing. I'm just so happy that O'Reilly's got this match. O'Reilly's been not underappreciated, but he's just not been given the chance to be a singles dude since for his entire run, really, in WWE. So I'm just thoroughly looking forward to a wrestling clinic and takeover. It's a week and a half away, which is madness, but I want it here now. Give me that takeover stuff right now. And those have been your NXT ups and downs for this week. This has been nice. I quite enjoyed coming in and filling in for Adam Cleary for 1 week. Maybe it was 1 week. Maybe I'll come back in the future. This is all depending on if you guys absolutely slam me in the comments section. Please don't do that because I'm one man. I'm only brittle. But do not forget to go online to YouTube, like, click and share, subscribe, do all the good stuff for these What Culture videos. Head on over to Twitter as well. Follow me at gmorgan04 and follow everybody here at What Culture at What Culture WWE. And, well, the most important thing above all else, have the best Thursday or whatever day it is that you're watching this you can. And hopefully we'll see you very, very soon.